Good morning and welcome to worship. My name is Tim Sievers and I'm the Connection Director here at Palouse Federated Church. And we're so glad you could join us. We're going to have a few video announcements in just a moment, but before that, I want to share with you a few announcements of my own. First off, we are continuing our Lamp and Light journey, our scripture memorization focus for the summer, and we have a new verse this week. It comes from James chapter 1, verses 2 to 3. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. In some versions, that also says perseverance. Along with our comeback series earlier this summer, we introduced the book by Tony Evans, Your Comeback. And Tony says that one of the ingredients for a comeback is endurance. And he writes, "Why does God test our faith and increase our endurance?" And then he quotes James 1:4, "So that endurance can have its perfect result, so that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing." God's goal, he says, is for your God's goal for your trials, he says, is for your growth into spiritual adulthood. And part of that is enduring. And so our scripture memorization verse, an ingredient for your comeback is from James 1, 2, and 3. The testing of your faith produces steadfastness. Our second announcement I want to share with you is that we are doing a supply drive for adult and teen challenge up in Spokane. And so we are through August 29th collecting various items for the men in the program, for the center to have as supplies. And so we want to invite you to be a part of that. So you can pick up here at the church, if you would like, a supply list of things that you can donate and help out. We'll also be talking about this more during the Spotlight on Giving, but we'd love to have you be a part of that. And everything that you donate, all these items that you donate, will be taken up to the Adult and Teen Challenge Center in Spokane to help in their ministry there, to help people battling addiction. So with that being said, I want to turn it over to some video announcements, and then we'll see Pastor Corey on the other side of the announcements.
Hi, I'm Betty Sawyer, and I'm going to talk to you today a little bit about our Bible studies that we're holding in person in most cases, and it's just so fun to get together and read about these big comebacks that are stronger than setbacks. Like this week we were talking about Elijah and how he needed a still small voice of God to come to him. It's just so good to get together with others and discuss the Bible. So if you're not involved yet, we just encourage you to ask about one of the Bible studies. I teach one on Wednesday mornings at 10 o'clock. And I know there are some on Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays that you can look into. So take some time, get to know this really good book, and we'll see you later.
Hi, my name is Lamy Newman.
And we're your youth leaders here at PFC. We have two separate groups that meet during the week. We have the middle school group, which Lamy will tell us about.
So the middle school group gets to meet on Wednesday nights at 6:30 to 7:30. And you guys are all welcome.
Then we have our high school group that meets from 7 to 8 on Tuesdays. And this group is a lot of fun as well, a little bit more studious than the middle school group. We have a great group of kids for both of them, and we would love to have your student join us. And if you have any questions, please feel free to contact either of us or the church.
Welcome to worship, everyone. It is a good day. It is a good day to worship God together. Thank you for joining us, whether you're listening on the radio at Bishop Place or whether you're joining us online, Facebook, YouTube, however you're joining us. Hey, it's good to be together and the Holy Spirit unites us. Let's start our worship service with prayer.
God, we thank you for bringing us together. We thank you for technology that allows us to join together in this way to worship you, God. We ask that your Holy Spirit would really meet with us today, that you would help us to hear your truth, that you would help us to see you, that you would work in our hearts today, O Lord, and that you would be glorified. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's worship together.
Hi, I'm Camille Wadley, and I'm going to be reading the call to worship, which is Psalm 111. Great are the Lord's works. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart in the company of the upright in the congregation. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them. Full of splendor and majesty is his work, and his righteousness endures forever. He has caused his wondrous works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and merciful. He provides food for those who fear him. He remembers his covenant forever. He has shown his people the power of his works in giving them the inheritance of the nations. The works of his hands are faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy. They are established forever and ever to be performed with faithfulness and uprightness. He sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding. His praise endures forever.
Yeah.
we need to pray. Jesus, when he's teaching the disciples to pray, he says, when you pray, not if you pray, when you pray. And we need to pray. We always do. We need that connection with God. We need to share our heart with God, let God share his heart with us. Tim always reminds me of that. We need to get honest with God about our struggles, and we need to give space for God to get honest with us, to really listen to God. And we need to pray, because if you look around this world, it is filled with fear and anxiety. There's so many people lost spiritually. There's people struggling. There's lots of division in our world right now, in our communities, you know, with the Delta variant, with all kinds of things going on. We need to pray, but we always have needed to pray. So let's join together as people who follow Christ, as people who believe in the good news of God. Let's not give up praying. Let's not give up praying. Let's pray sincerely, not out of fear, not out of desperation, but to really connect with our God, and to be really in relational communication with our God, and bringing the needs of one another, of our brothers and sisters, of our neighbors, to God. Let's be praying. Okay, will you join me in prayer now? We're going to pray the Lord's Prayer as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, Father, we need you. We need you. Lord, we praise you that you know our deep needs. You know the broken condition we are in without you. You know the ways we wander from you, even when we know you. We need you, Lord. We need your mercy. We need your Spirit guiding us. We need your help, O Lord. Lord, I ask that your Spirit right now would touch the people that are part of this service, and help them to see that you want to meet with them, not just at this service today, but throughout this upcoming week. You want to meet with them daily. You want us to listen to you, to bring our concerns before you. And so we do that with you now, but draw us deeper into a walk with you, Lord. Lord, we bring before you the needs of our own life, our families, our neighbors, our brothers and sisters in our churches, Lord, our communities and this world. We bring before you those who are hurting from disease, whether it be cancer or whether it be a chronic illness, or perhaps COVID-19. We pray, O Lord, that you would be our hope and our healing. We pray also against the fears in this world, the disease of fear, the disease of divisiveness, the disease of anger that runs rampant. O Lord, help us to find better ways in you. Help us to find true unity in you. Help us to be peacemakers, for you said, blessed are the peacemakers. Lord, help us to treat one another with respect, even when we disagree. Oh Lord, there is so much division, so much anxiety, confusion, what to believe, what not to believe, about things we hear in the news, about things we hear in our own communities. Oh Lord, but you are to be believed. You are always to be trusted. So help us to begin our days this week by seeking you as our foundation, our source of truth, our refuge. You are a refuge for any time of trouble. Lord, grant your wisdom to us and help us to seek your path this week. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
My second reading is from Ephesians 5:15-20. Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is, and do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving always thanks and for everything to God the Father, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ.
For our spotlight on giving today, I want to talk with you a little bit about the Adult and Teen Challenge program. Adult and Teen Challenge has been a partner of ours for a while now, and if, for those of you who don't know, it's a faith-based residential discipleship program that works to help people overcome addiction. And we have a great connection to the center in Spokane, and they've been working with us, and we've been working with them over the last couple of years. They've helped us with some projects around the church, and we've been helping to provide some supplies for them. The Adult and Teen Challenge Center in Spokane is supported completely by donations. They don't get funding from any government agency or anything like that. And so they rely on the generosity of people like you and I, and through donations of items to help them perform their important mission here in the Pacific Northwest. And so this month through August 29th, we are doing a supply drive to help them get what they need to aid in their mission and get these men to a place where they have overcome addiction and they are mentally sound and emotionally balanced and socially adjusted, physically well, and spiritually alive. And so we want to invite you to be a part of that. We have distributed a list of items, and for those of you who are watching online, you should be able to see that coming up on the screen right now. List of personal items like towels and shampoo, supplies for the center like trash bags and toilet paper and paper plates, and items for the health room like ibuprofen and vitamins and things like that. So if you want to be a part of that, we invite you to bring your donations by the 29th of August so we can get those up to the center. Now, every time you give to Palouse Federated Church, you are giving to support Adult and Teen Challenge, because a portion of your tithes and offerings we give back through our missions budget to them. So we invite you to be a part of that and to do this as well. If you want to give financially to our mission and ministry here on the Palouse, you can do that in person at the church through the mail or even online at palousechurch.org. So thank you for your faithful giving to Palouse Federated Church. And if you have any questions about how you can connect to our mission and ministry, just give us a shout out here at the church and send us an email. So thank you so much.
Friends, we're in the Gospel according to John today. John chapter 9, that's the fourth book of the New Testament. It goes Matthew, Mark, Luke, then John. And we're in John chapter 9. We're covering the same story we did last week, the whole chapter of John 9, the story of man born blind, healed by Jesus. Now, you can also use the Bible app. It's also called YouVersion. The Bible app is a great way to have the Bible at home or have the Bible in your pocket with you, always on your smartphone. And under the options in the Bible app is an events option, and you can find our electronic church bulletin, you could call it, right there with sermon outline, announcements, links, inside the Bible app. So check that out under events. But we're in the Gospel of John chapter 9, and last week we asked this story to teach us to see how Jesus sees. And some of you prayed along with me this week, Lord, help me to see how Jesus sees. I want to tell you, that's been a challenging prayer for me. God's been challenging me to see better, see people better, see people how He sees. So today we're coming to the same story of John 9, this man born blind, but also this man that Jesus healed completely, fully. And the man leaves seeing, but interestingly, the religious people, the religious leaders, end up being spiritually blind throughout this whole story. They are the ones that, though they're supposed to be the experts on God, the religious people miss seeing who Jesus really is. So today we ask the Spirit, we're going to ask the Spirit to help us to see Jesus, to help us to see Him for who He really is. Let's pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts, may they be pleasing and acceptable in Your sight, O Lord. For You are truly our rock and our Redeemer. You alone should we rightly fear. You alone should we fully follow. You alone should our life be founded upon. Lord, give us eyes to see. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, I want to read the whole chapter of John 9 today, starting, of course, with verse 1. Jesus is in Jerusalem at the Feast of Tabernacles. Though His life is been threatened, He's about to heal and teach some amazing lessons. John 9, starting with verse 1. As He passed by, He saw a man blind from birth, and His disciples asked Him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, It was not that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. We must work the works of Him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Having said these things, He spit on the ground and made mud with the saliva. Then He anointed the man's eyes with the mud and said to him, Go, wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. So he went and washed and came back seeing. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar were saying, Is this not the man who used to sit and beg? Some said, It is he. Others said, No, but he is like him. He kept saying, I am the man. So they said to him, Then how were your eyes opened? He answered, The man called Jesus made mud and anointed my eyes and said to me, Go to Siloam and wash. So I went and washed and received my sight. They said to him, Where is he? He said, I do not know. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. So the Pharisees again asked him how he had received his sight. And he said to them, He put mud on my eyes, and I washed, and I see. Some of the Pharisees said, This man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath. But others said, How can a man who is a sinner do such signs? And there was a division among them. So they said again to the blind man, What do you say about him, since he has opened your eyes? He said, He is a prophet. The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked them, Is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he now see? His parents answered, We know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but how he now sees we do not know, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him, he is of age, he will speak for himself. His parents said these things because they feared the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that if anyone should confess Jesus to be the Christ, he was to be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, He is of age, ask him. So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind and said to him, Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner. He answered, Whether he is a sinner, I do not know. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see. They said to him, What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? He answered them, I have told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you want to become his disciples? And they reviled him, saying, You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from. The man answered, Why, this is an amazing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but if anyone is a worshiper of God and does his will, God listens to him. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a man born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. They answered him, You were born in utter sin, and would you teach us? And they cast him out. Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and having found him, said, Do you believe in the Son of Man? He answered, And who is he, sir, that I may believe in him? Jesus said to him, You have seen him, and it is he who is speaking to you. He said, Lord, I believe. And he worshipped him. Jesus said, For judgment I came into this world, that those who do not see may see, and those who see may become blind. Some of the Pharisees near him heard these things and said to him, Are we also blind? Jesus said to them, If you were blind, you would have no guilt. But now that you say, We see, your guilt remains. The word of the Lord. Well, do we really care who Jesus is? Do I really care who Jesus is? Do I just want my version of Jesus, or do I want the actual Jesus? In that time, they were waiting for the Messiah, the chosen one of God. Did they want the real Messiah, or their own definition, their own idea of who the Messiah was? So in this story, we can learn about who Jesus is. And so through its different pieces, we're going to go through the flow of the story today, and we're going to see the people who got it and the people who didn't get it. Right, the man who was healed, he's the one that got it. And then the others who didn't see and didn't get it. Right? So we're going to go through the story, the parts of the story. First, let's talk about the pool. The pool, the blind man, after he had the mud anointing his eyes, Jesus sent him to the pool. Right? This pool was part of the Feast of the Tabernacles. It was part of the Jerusalem layout of that city, But it's also just a natural place for Jesus to send somebody who's got mud on his face and on his eyes, right? Yeah, you know, he needs to go wash. But it's Jesus sending him to be washed. Jesus is the one who was sent into this world, and Jesus is also the one who's going to send people out to declare who he is. But here Jesus is giving this blind man, at the time he was a blind man, this practical next step to go wash his eyes. Now it also buys Jesus some time to step away from the scene and to allow the other parts of this story to unfold. John, the writer of this gospel, makes a connection between Siloam, the name for this pool, and the word sent. And so Jesus is the sent one from God. The Gospel of John is about believing that Jesus is the chosen one of God, the Son of God. And Jesus is the sender. Jesus is also going to send us out into the world. So Jesus is sent and Jesus is sender. And here we see him sending the man to go and wash. And doesn't he call us all to go and wash, right? To be made clean by the forgiveness of Christ, to be made new. So Jesus is the one who was sent by the Father, and he is the one who sends us to that washing, to that new life. But then the story continues, and we see the neighbors get involved, right? The people who were around this formerly blind man, the people who passed by him, the neighbors are involved, and they are amazed and confused. Is this him or is it not, right? And after Jesus hits our life, we're going to confuse some people, right? After he washes us and makes us clean and changes our priorities and changes our purpose, it often can leave other people asking questions. Sometimes it's those people closest to us, maybe our own neighbors, maybe our own family, saying, are you really the same person now? And the truth is, we aren't exactly the same. We might have the same body, right? We might mostly look the same, but we're not the same. In this case, for the formerly blind man, his eyes were literally made new. But, you know, the rest of his body's going to look pretty much the same. But others are looking at him saying, is this the guy? Well, it's not exactly the same guy, right? His identity has been changed. He's been born anew. So when you think about this, when you are touched by Jesus, if you're out there believing, this has already happened for you if you believe in Jesus. But if you're out there considering Jesus, this is what happens, right? You are changed by Jesus. And he changes things that could be noticed by others and can amaze them or confuse them. It might be that he changes a very negative attitude into a hopeful attitude. Or he takes something away from you, a bad habit, and you find an area of strength that you just didn't have before Jesus, right? Or he gives you a sense of purpose where you had none before. You know, for me, one of the things that kind of maybe can seem little to some people, but one of the things that changed for me basically immediately when I came into relationship with Christ was I had a habit of cursing. Now, I wouldn't curse around, you know, people like my parents or, you know, in places where I might get in trouble for that. But, you know, around my friends and just in common everyday practice, I did that, you know, and it was just my habit. Honestly, without much work of my own, I guess you could say just by the grace of God, that just kind of fell away. And I didn't really notice that first. And I remember playing ping pong and, you know, at a college ping pong table, and I was always cussing when I was playing ping pong. And one of my friends was like, you're different. Am I different? It wasn't my backhand or my forehand. It was that I wasn't cussing when something went wrong, you know. And you know, and God just took that away from me. That habit fell away. Now, you know, not everything is that immediate, but I think God wants to give signs to other people that he's been at work in us. Sometimes he takes something away, like a bad habit, and sometimes he adds things immediately that are very noticeable to others. And other things are a growth process. But when we are changed by Christ, when we are washed by him, when we are made new, something essential changes for all of us, right? Our identity is changed. We are now a renewed, restored child of God. And that in some way is identifiable, okay? I just want to say that. And that is our true identity. The next thing in the story, the religious leaders, the neighbors bring in the religious leaders, and that kind of makes sense. What do you do? Something just, you know, world shaking has happened. A man born blind is given sight. So who else do you want to bring in to verify a miracle but the God people, right? This has to be a God thing because this guy was formerly blind, so you bring in the people who teach about God. That makes sense, right? But, you know, when the religious leaders get there, you think maybe we'll have a praise and worship service. But no, they're not joyous, even though this world-shaking thing has happened. Instead, they're questioning how it happened. And okay, it happened on the Sabbath, so that can't be good. And the guy who did it can't be good, right? It can't be of God, because he broke our Sabbath interpretations. And we're the God people, after all. Now, they're wrong on that, but that's their thinking. So the religious people get involved, and they're saying, you know, okay, so this amazing thing was done, but a sin was done to do it. He violated the Sabbath, and sinners can't do good things, so therefore this isn't a good thing, and therefore it isn't from God, even though it's a man who was blind and now can see. And so there is even a division initially among those religious leaders. Some are saying, well, but can a sinner really do something that good? That's a good common sense question. I mean, it's a good thing. And others are just stuck in their tradition, their religion, saying, nah, it can't be good, okay? So there's even a division initially amongst those religious leaders. So then they ask the man, well, what do you think? And of course, the man is like, well, he was blind and now he sees. And they say, what do you think about the man? And the man says, well, he's a prophet. Now notice that the man who was formerly blind, he says, a man called Jesus. That's first how he refers to Jesus. And now when he's asked directly, he says, he's a prophet. And then we'll see what he says at the end of the story. Like, he's learning in a process who Jesus really is, right? So after the religious leaders don't really get anywhere with the formerly blind man, they choose to bring in the parents to see if they can maybe discredit the healed man's story. And they on the whole, even though there was disagreement, on the whole it seems like they didn't really believe this miracle, right? And so they bring in the parents to interrogate them, and the parents obviously know their child, right? They know his former blindness. They've lived intimately with that struggle. They remember him, I'm sure, as a baby, and the things that were difficult for him not ever being able to see. But they don't know completely what has happened. But they do know, according to John's comment in this story, that if they give Jesus credit for healing him, that's going to have a really negative effect on their life. Because the religious leaders had let it be known that if any way you hint that Jesus is the Christ, if you're confessing that Jesus is the Christ, you're going to be put out of the synagogue, meaning you're going to not be able to worship with your fellow Jewish people, but you're also going to have people cut off relationships with you. Your life is going to get very uncomfortable and difficult. And so they've put the fear factor out there, right? You know, and that seems unfair, like believe in Jesus or not, but instead they put in this obstacle between Jesus and people, like, hey, Jesus is saying the Messiah, but if you want to get to him, there's all these penalties. And that's causing these people, like these parents, to fear. They could lose their place of worship. They could lose business partners or friendships or family connection, right? And they've already been a family who's gone through the struggle of having a blind child and probably been called names, and maybe people have made accusations about them being cursed or them being at fault for their child's issue. And so they bow to the fear, basically. They bow to the fear of not wanting to reveal too much or not wanting to give Jesus credit for this miracle. And it reminds me of, you know, that Peter, too, one of the disciples, after 3 years of walking with Jesus, when Jesus is arrested, Peter denies Jesus 3 times. He bows to the fear when people ask him if he's with Jesus. He 3 times says that he isn't, that he's not one of his followers, you know? And so we have that temptation, even after following Jesus, of kind of bowing to that pull of popularity or the pull of the world to go with whatever the world says is cool or good instead of what God and God's Word says, okay? And we don't want to be cast out by our friends. We don't want to be declared unpopular. And so we learn that lesson from the parents here. They decide, you know, we're going to take the easy way out, basically. We don't want to face the penalty. We don't want to lose the comforts we have, the connections we have. So they put it back on their son. Go ask him. He is of age, okay? And so that means that the religious leaders go back to the healed blind man again, this second encounter with the healed man, And it's really a priceless encounter. In a way, I'm really glad that the parents sent them back, because this is when, you know, if this was a boxing match, this is when the healed blind man really lands some blows. I mean, he has just got a straightforward, logical argument that he beats them, right? He beats these learned, educated, supposedly godly, but not really, men at their own game, okay? He questions their motives. Why are you asking me again? Do you really want to know? You know, what are your motives? You know, that he tries to get them thinking. They are flustered. They're losing this logical argument, you know, which is basically, you know, God doesn't listen to sinners and something good was done here. So what are you going to do with that? No one has ever seen a man born blind healed. And so couldn't that only come from God? They don't really have an answer for that. So all they can do is, in being flustered, all they can do is just end up calling him a name. And that happens to us sometimes too, right? When we're standing up for something and we have a good foundation and people don't like that we're representing Christ or standing on truth or something, and they just call us a name, right? I remember one time in college, a guy behind me wanted me to share my answers on a test when the instructor left the room. And I was like, no way, buddy. He's like, oh, you're just one of those goody two-shoes. It's like, is that all you got? I mean, that didn't offend me. It's like, yeah, okay, call me goody two-shoes, whatever. So here we see this wonderful thing happen, that the smart, learned, powerful people of the world are bested by a formerly blind beggar, right? And Jesus tells us in the Beatitudes that his people, his disciples, he says, you're blessed when people end up persecuting you or reviling you, all on account of following Jesus. If people are going to call us names for doing the right thing or for following Jesus or for standing up for God's word, oh well, okay. Jesus says, actually, that's a happy state of affairs. Blessed are you when you're persecuted or reviled for sticking up for Jesus. God's word also says that God likes to use the weak to shame the strong. Or hear this, the words of 1 Corinthians 1:28. It says, God chose what is low and despised in the world, even the things that are not, to bring to nothing the things that are. So God was using this blind man and making him smarter than the scholars to really level the scholars, right? God chooses what appears to be low and despised according to the world, and God likes to do that, to show the world that you don't have the real strength, power, and wisdom, that all really comes from God, okay? So the religious leaders are bested, and all they're left with is name calling. But that leaves us then to this man, the man who is no longer blind, the man who we don't learn his name. He's called all these awkward phrases, the man born blind, the man who was formerly blind. But now this man can see physically. He's been cast out of the synagogue, right? He's been called names, but he can see. And now he's going to see more than just physically. It's going to be revealed to him that right in front of him is the Son of Man. Jesus comes and finds him. Jesus hears that he's cast out. Remember last week we heard Jesus sees, right? He sees. He knows what's going on. So he knew this man was cast out, and he went and he found him. That in itself is beautiful. And Jesus wants to introduce himself more formally, I guess you could say. He wants to tell him, hey, do you believe in the Son of Man? Because I am the Son of Man. That's what Jesus wants to tell him. It's just awesome. So this formerly blind man, with his brand new sight, right, his brand new physical sight, is now able to see what others have longed to see. The Son of God in the flesh, right? Son of Man is just a term from the Old Testament that means the divine presence of God, really. And so here, this man is privileged to see God in the flesh. God's love in human form, he's getting to see with his own eyes. Isn't that awesome? And really, we should all long to see what he saw that day. And think about it. He hasn't earned this. No one can deserve seeing something so beautiful, seeing the Son of God in the flesh. But God is that good. God is that merciful that he wants this man to see him. He wants to introduce himself to him. and he wants to do the same for you, right? So this world, very different than Jesus on its own, right? The world is lost in its labels. The world then and now is lost in its labels. Isn't this the blind man, the cursed man, you know? He's born this way, and we still do that. People are born a certain way, we say, and that's who they are, and we can't deny it, and we should just affirm whatever their label is. You know, God doesn't so much care about our worldly labels and our worldly identities. He may have not been born with sight, but the world said, therefore, he was cursed, and that label was wrong. You know? Jesus comes in, and he doesn't care about what we say about people, or even what we say about ourselves, right? How we identify ourselves with a disease or a diagnosis or whatever it is. Okay? It's really popular to label yourself as a chosen behavior, as a political party, as something to do with your sexuality, or whatever. And we take these things and we make them primary about our identity. And that is an act of pride, I think. It's saying that we know what is most important about us. It's a self-important activity. And then if anybody says we're different than that or more than that, we take that as an insult because it's so important to us. But here Jesus comes in and he sees, you know, you're not who the world says you are. And you're not just who you were born as. There's something more about you. There's an image of God stamped on you that the world's covered over. The world's covered over it by calling you cursed, only allowing for you to be a beggar. But you are something more than that. You're a child of God that I love. And I want to help you to fully see that love and invite you into relationship with me. Jesus invites this man into relationship with him. And the man declares, Lord, I believe. And it's beautiful. This relationship between this man and his God is fully restored. And that's demonstrated when he worships him. Now, Jewish people didn't worship other human beings. So what this man just knows by his faith is that Jesus is not just a human being. Jesus deserves worship. Therefore, Jesus is God. That's who you worship. You worship God. This man worships God. Worships Jesus, the Son of Man, Jesus, the Divine One. So, what a beautiful gift that Jesus went and found this man. And this tells us what the world is like, or what the Lord is like, I should say. The Son of Man, Jesus. What is he like? He's a God who reaches out to us. And I started this message by saying we should care about who Jesus really is. Well, who is Jesus? He is the God who reaches out to us. He's the God who was sent to this world. He's the God who reaches out to us. He's a healing and rescuing God. Now, the people who think they don't need God's healing, the people who think that they aren't blind, that they've got it on their own, they want the worldly labels, they want to figure it out without God. You know, God loves them too, but he wants them to shed all that and really see. But they're blind because they think they can see, right? But God comes into this world to help us truly see, to help us remove our blindness. God came into this world to help save us from our broken ways. But we need to look to him for our identity. We need to look to him for our leadership. Right? It's not our job to self-identify ourselves. It's our job to receive our God-given identity, our primary identity, as beloved sons or daughters of the King. So the formerly blind man looks to him, and with open eyes he says, I believe, right? Lord, I believe, and then worships. So amazing. And I pray that has happened for you. Have you? That's a simple way to pray. I know there's a longer sinner's prayer that you could pray to come into relationship with Jesus, but you can simply pray this, Lord, I believe, and then worship him. You don't have to have a fancy prayer to come into relationship with Jesus. If you want to believe in him right now, you can say that out loud. You can say that quietly in your heart. Say it. If you believe, just say, Lord, I believe. And worship him, right? Worship him. Well, this story, to wrap it up, it causes us to ask questions. And that's really, I think, one of the things John is doing with his gospel. He's wanting the readers, the people who read or hear this gospel, to ask questions about who is Jesus and do they believe in him, right? So there's questions we should ask from this story. So we should be asking, where is Jesus from? Where is Jesus from? The religious leaders say, we don't know where he's from, right? And John is like, that's kind of the point. Do you know that he's from heaven? Do you know that he's from eternity? The blind man knows, right? Or the formerly blind man knows that Jesus is divine. He's from eternity. That Jesus is from God. So do you believe this? Do you believe what Jesus says about himself? Where he is from? Is from God the Father? That God the Father sent him? And the next question, who is Jesus? Who is Jesus? Well, this story teaches us Jesus is the one who can open our eyes, truly. And the truth is, on our own, we're blind. We see things unclearly. Now, we may think we see things rightly. We may think we've got the world figured out on our own. But only God sees things perfectly. And God sees that we needed Jesus Christ in the world to save us. We needed the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ to change us, to restore us, to give us everlasting life. We needed that. Now, you may not see that, or you may think you don't need the cross, or you may think you don't need the resurrection, or you may think you don't need certain moral teachings of the Bible because you know better. But the truth is, God sees and God knows. And we best trust what God sees and what God tells us and ask for his eyes to see, right? Jesus is the one. Who is Jesus? Jesus is the one who came to earth from the Father, knowing your needs and seeing everything broken, everything beautiful about you, right? And wanting to come and find you like he found that formerly blind man and invite you into a relationship with him. So, Lord, open our eyes that we may see. Without you, Lord, we are blind. Open our eyes, Lord. Open our eyes. Amen. Our next steps today, I think they're on the screen. You can comment below, or if you prefer, or if you're listening on the radio, you can email next@palousechurch.org or Corey, C-O-R-E-Y, @palousechurch.org. Let me know if any of these next steps hit you. If you feel like you resonated too much with the Pharisees in this story and you feel you've been blinded by religion and you're still blind and you want help with that, that's option number one, is just to admit, I feel blinded by my religion. Okay? Let's talk about that. It's not a permanent condition. It doesn't need to be. Step two is just a declaration. I want to know Jesus more. I want to know Jesus more. I want to see him more. Do you want that? Okay. And number three, we have a prayer for the week, like we had a prayer for last week. Last week's was, Lord, help me see how Jesus sees. Simply this week is, our prayer for the week is, Lord, help me to know you more. Help me to know you more. If you want to join me in praying that throughout your work week, praying that daily, just you can say number three on the comment line, or again, send me an email, and we'll pray that together. Well, thanks be to God for his good word, and thanks be to God that he opens our eyes and invites us to see him and see his love.
Thank you.
May God help you to see how Jesus sees. May God and God's Spirit help you to grow in knowing Jesus more this week. God loves you very much. God came to earth, was sent to earth as Jesus the Christ to find you, to introduce you to himself. I pray you have a great week, and I pray you use it to know our Lord more.